So, this is SCIRun. This is probably, if you did not get this interface when you opened it up, then let me know now so we can fix it. This is generally what it looks like. And SCIRun is a problem-solving environment, is the term that we use for it. And what that essentially means is that it's a application that allows you to solve problems, but you can bring in data, you can manipulate data, you can visualize it, you can do simulations and all sorts of stuff. And the main uses I find for SCIRun are visualizing data, editing and manipulating geometries and data, and then running different kinds of simulations. So these up here are macros. You don't need to worry about those. And these favorites you can set. I'll show you how to do that.
Okay.
So as Nate pointed out, over here we have a window with a bunch of stuff in it. These are called modules, and this is the module search window. You can search for them by name, or you can go down and select them. And if you find one that you use a lot, like say this one right here, you can hit the star and it'll show up under your favorites for easy access. Now, what is a module? A module is essentially a collection of code that's all packaged up and performs a certain function. For example, one of the most common ones that you'll use is this one called read field. Okay, and so you saw what I did there. I just took it from over here in the module window and drug it into the main interface right here. You can also double click it and that will also bring it in. If you click on something, it gets highlighted, and if you hit the delete or backspace button, it gets rid of it. And then you can also drag it around in there, which is a little bit motion sickness inducing. So on any given module, there will be a different number of things. There will be ports. So that's these little colored rectangles. There's input ports that come into the top of the module. There's output ports that come into the bottom. And you can see if you click on a port and then drag, it starts to make what's called a pipe. Okay? And the different colors do have different meanings. So let's go ahead and have everyone drag a read field into their screen. Okay. Read field is one of the generic ways that we take something, a data file, into SCIRun. Okay, and so it reads it in as a field. A field is a SCIRun data type that usually is corresponding to a geometry that has data and other information associated with it. So if we hover over the read field, we'll see several different buttons. There's a kind of a play button, a question button, an exclamation point, like little settings wheel, and then a three lines button. Okay, if we click on this three lines button, it opens up the interface for this module. Every module that has an interface, it usually looks different. And so for this one, as you might expect, it's a kind of a dialogue where you are gonna look up a file, okay? Now everybody downloaded all of the data files, right? And unzipped them, okay? We're gonna go ahead and have Ben share screen now, and he'll be the one driving for a second. So go ahead and hit that open button. Okay, this is gonna pull up a dialog where we're gonna go looking for that data. So go navigate to wherever you save that data.
Oh. Oh, I thought it was in here.
Okay, so It probably is in there, but if you remember looking at the data, that data was of type .mat. SCIRun can import a bunch of different things. And as you just pulled up, these are all the different types of fields that SCIRun can import. Go ahead and scroll down until you find the one called MATLAB field. Yep, there you go. Okay, now it shows up. Go ahead and select SOC. Okay. So now if you go up to the, you can close the read field dialog. And if anybody gets behind, stop us so we can help you catch up. So go ahead and go up to the very top of the SCIRun window. There should be a little triangle that's green. It looks like a play button.
Yeah.
Okay, that's the execute button. It's going to take any module in the main window, and it's going to execute it or run whatever its function is. So now, you know, nothing really looks like it's happened, but that read field module has loaded in that data. And if any of the modules fail, they will turn red. Now, before we go any further, there's a very important thing you need to do whenever you're using SCIRun, and that's called saving, and saving often. So go up, to file and save, or just hit the little save icon.
Have them change the preference.
Yeah, yeah, I will. Save it as whatever you want, name it whatever. Leave it as a .SCIRun 5, but save it as whatever you want to save it as. Okay. So, saving manually is all well and good, but as Wilson alluded to, there's a better way, and that is to tell SCIRun to save every time that you run the network. So go ahead and go up to SCIRun up at the top. So it should be, let's see, I don't know where it is on Windows. Should be under file, perhaps.
File, okay.
Yeah, I guess file.
No, I don't see it. So for Mac users, you're going to go to SCIRun and preferences. For a Windows user, let's see.
If he runs the new module wizard, it will do it, I'm pretty sure. But that's not how you typically go through it. Try window real quick.
Yeah, go to window.
Preferences.
Oh, yep, there it is. All right. Does everybody have the preferences window up? I assume yes. All right. Auto save before execute. Click that. It should be under network editor. Man, why you gotta have a Windows version?
Oh, there we go. Okay.
Okay. So now every time you hit the play button, it will save the network, which is really good because sometimes you add a new module and it causes the whole thing to crash, and at least your progress is saved. So now go ahead and close that preferences window. All right, so now we've loaded data in, but that's not really very useful because, you know, we're not looking at it. So let's go ahead and go over to our module finder window, and let's find a show field. So go up to the search function and type in show, and then pick show field and drag it onto the, yep, there you go. All right, now you're going to go ahead and drag a pipe from the yellow output of read field to the yellow input of show field. Okay, did everybody accomplish that? All right, now go ahead and hit execute. All right, so you might notice that nothing happened again. Right, and that's because we need one more step in order to actually visualize this data, and that's called a view scene. So go find a view scene module. There it is. And so you notice this one has pink input ports, which are view scene ports. So go ahead and drag the, yep, there you go. Okay, now, what? Everybody good?
It disappeared or like... Oh, no, never mind.
It went off to the side of the screen.
How do I...
Yeah, okay. We'll deal with this in a second.
Okay.
I'll show you how to deal with this in a second. Go ahead and just hit execute. This is kind of an idiosyncrasy of SCIRun. All right. So now if you go down to that view scene module and hit the interface button, which should be on the far right. Yeah, that one. It brings up the view scene, right? And go ahead and make that window a little bit bigger. You guys might be able to hear my dog sleeping in the background, barking in her sleep. So go ahead and right next to that settings button up at the top, there's the button with the four arrows on it. Hit that. That's going to center our view. And now if you kind of click and drag, you can rotate the sock around and look at it. Has everybody gotten to this point? Rather, has anyone not gotten to this point?
Okay, I think awesome. I just hit the wrong file to load, so give me 1 second while I change that.
Okay, we are going to switch to you next, Nate. So as Ben pointed out, it gets stuck over here, right? When you put the view scene in, it wants the view scene to be in the bottom corner like this, and it kind of prevents you from centering your view. The easiest way to do that is to get a dummy module like create string. Create string, you know, it just creates a string, like a series of words, but it doesn't need to have any inputs. And I just take two of those and put one of them in one corner and one in the other corner, and then I can arrange things how I want them to be. It kind of helps make things a little bit prettier. So Nate, go ahead and share screen with us.
Okay.
All right. So congratulations. You have read in data and visualize, or you've read in something and visualized it, right? And as you might have guessed, this is a sock mesh, but as I imagine Wilson was leading you to ask about, what kind of mesh is this from our discussion last week?
The type of mesh.
Right. Is this mesh representing a volume or a surface or individual points? Like, what's going on? I mean,
it looks like it's got the edges and some sort of thickness to it. But actually, now that I'm zooming in, it just looks like it's points and edges.
Okay. And so that makes it what kind of a mesh? It's okay if you guys don't. This is a surface mesh. Specifically, it's a triangulated surface mesh. And one way that that SCIRun will tell you that is if you go hover over the pipe, the yellow pipe, and hit click it, and then hit I on your keyboard. That brings up the information about this pipe. And somewhere on the top of that, up in that first line, it says tri-surf mesh, which means triangulated surface mesh. Okay, it also tells you a bunch of other things like how many nodes there are, how many elements there are. Right, so remember our discussion last week, do we think there's going to be more faces or element or nodes? In this case, you can see there's 247 nodes and 467 faces. And it also tells you information about the data that's on there. And currently there is no data on there. Right, let's fix that. Okay. We want some data. So if you'll remember looking at the three different files I sent you, one of them was called data. And it's in the form of a MATLAB matrix. So instead of reading in a field, we need to read in a matrix. So let's go ahead and do a read matrix module. Okay, and go ahead and open it up and navigate to the data. Hold on. So this is gonna be the bane of your existence using SCIRun. Look at what file type we're using.
Mm-hmm.
It's a SCIRun matrix file .mat. But the file that I've saved out and the file that you'll most likely be working with is actually a MATLAB matrix.
Okay.
Okay. So it'll look like it loads correctly, but then when you hit execute, the whole thing blows up.
Hmm. Okay.
Right. Gotcha. They haven't seen a module fail, so it might be fun to just see.
Well, I saw everything go red. I ran the read field a couple of times when it was by itself.
Okay.
Okay. So, go ahead and hit run. Okay. Now go to the blue port and click it and hit I. Or middle mouse click if you have a mouse.
Oh, there we go.
Okay. So that brought up the data or the information about our data matrix. And so as you can see, it has 247 rows and 337 columns, right? Do either of those dimensions match up with our geometry?
I mean, the number of points, right?
Right.
Well, yeah, the number of nodes is the number of rows.
Right, and so what we're probably looking at in this data, right, is 247 different entries at 330 whatever time points. Right. So if each node in our sock mesh is an electrode, then each of the entries in this matrix is a voltage value at a given time. Now, I don't know about you, but I have a hard time looking at 337 time instances all at once on a geometry. So we should probably pick out an individual time instant to look at. In order to do that, we're going to go ahead and grab a set field data. There you go. Okay. And go ahead and pipe our field, which is our sock, into the yellow port.
Is there a better way?
I don't know why you're there. There you go. Okay. And then go ahead and pipe our data into the second port, right? Okay, now go ahead and delete the port or the pipe going into show field. Okay, now go ahead and pipe the output of set field data into show field.
Oh, this is going to get messy fast.
One thing I would suggest you do, unless you like this line style, you can go into preference and change what shape the lines take.
A cubic.
Yeah, so go over Windows, Preferences. No, don't do cubic. Don't listen to Wilson. I do Manhattan, but you can look at what cubic looks like if you wanted, you know.
Oh, gross. Oh, no. Okay, great.
Yeah, don't do the spaghetti option. All right, do you think this is going to work?
I think it's not supposed to, just based off of what you how you said that, but okay, other than that, I have no other inclination.
Okay, so it didn't work. So let's go ahead and go to the red the first red module, the set matrix, and hit the I. This is going to tell us what happened. Okay, matrix dimensions do not match any of the field dimensions. Right, so that's telling us that data that you sent in, it's not matching up with what we're giving it, right? And the problem with that is that we're taking a 247 node and we're trying to assign this whole matrix to it somehow.
Yeah.
It doesn't know how to do that. So we need to just take out one individual time instant and assign it to this mesh. So go ahead and grab a get matrix slice.
So I got an error with my read matrix.
Okay, did you make sure to set it as a MATLAB matrix rather than a SCIRun matrix?
I thought so. So I go to data, right, and I do...
Yeah, so you do open.
Oh, yep, okay. Yeah, that was it.
Yep, that'll get you every time. Go ahead. That looks good. All right, so now... Instead of piping that directly into set field data, we need to take a slice of it first, right? And so this is going to either take one column out of the data and pass it as a vector, or take one row out of the data and pass it as a vector. Yep, so that's right. Go ahead. And then pipe the output of that to our set field data.
And I assume that the light blue is some sort of integer.
Right, that's some sort of, but we don't need to worry about that for this exact for this specific one. Okay. So go ahead and go into the interface of get matrix slice. So if you go hover the module, the three bars at the very end is the interface. All right, so this pulls up the get matrix slice. We're telling it to take a column slice, which is correct because if you remember, we had 256 rows and some number of columns. Okay, and then we're telling it which index to select. So before you can change any of this without having it have an issue, go ahead and run it once. So run the whole network. Yep. And then let's switch it to a more interesting time point, say 50. All right, now hit run. Nothing happened. So let's go into our show field and figure out why that might be. No, the interface at the very end.
Oh, this one?
On show field. The three bars.
Okay.
Okay. So we're telling it to show faces, which we can see. But when we look at the face coloring, it's selected as default rather than some sort of color map lookup. Okay. A color map lookup is going to say whatever the data is, color it accordingly.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And we prefer to have it that way. The problem is we haven't given our show field any color maps to work with, and so it has no way of doing a color map lookup. So go ahead and close all the windows by hitting the X button. There's also a shortcut right above the module selector. There's an arrow, there's a plus, and then there's an X. The X one will close all open windows. Okay, go ahead and grab a create standard color map and a rescale color map. Okay, so what these two modules are doing is the first one is creating a color map object, right? And that's a way of mapping data to color, but by default, it maps it from a 0 to 1 range, right? And we want it to be mapped to whatever the data range of our data is. So take the create standard color map and pass it into the rescale color map like that. Yep. And then take the output of rescale color map and send it to the show field. Okay. Now take the set field data output and send it to the rescale color map.
Should I delete this?
No, nope.
Okay.
There you go. All right, now if you hit play up at the top, let's see what happens. Okay, go look at your data, or go look at your view scene. Nothing's happened yet, and that's because we haven't told the show field to use the color map lookup. So go into the show field's options and tell it to use color map lookup. There we go. We visualized the data.
Oh, there we go. Come back.
All right, let's go ahead and switch to Michael now.
Oh, poor guy.
Well, I didn't want to slow you guys down, so I haven't installed it yet. I was just kind of watching and trying to understand.
Oh, shame.
Don't shame me.
Nope, public shaming. All right, let's switch back to Ben. Thank you, Nate. So let's go ahead and view your view scene. Okay, cool. Now, do you know what the red color means? What value it corresponds to?
No. Usually red is high, right?
Well, there's an easy way for us to, there's a couple ways for us to tell. Let's go ahead and go to our create standard color map. Okay, so this is the color map we're currently working with. It's the rainbow. And as you can see, on one end is blue, on the other end is red, and it's a gradation from that. And by default, the way SCIRun works is the one on the left is the low value, and the one on the right is the high value. Go ahead and switch it to a different color map, just to play with it. So there should be a little drop. Should be a little drop down where it says rainbow. Keep going.
Oh. mixed grayscale is a no go.
Okay. Mixed rainbow. What's?
Oh, don't do that one.
Oh, don't. Okay, all right.
That's horrifying. Plasma.
White and blue.
Yeah. There. That's good. Now hit run.
Oh, as in run like.
Yeah.
Is it blue or purple, Jake?
That's pink. That's like violet.
No, I'm just that was the color map I used the other week that we were debating.
Oh, it's blue. It's blue on one end. okay, so that's how you can change color maps, okay? But that still doesn't tell us what numbers correspond to what, okay? Let's check one more place before we add any new modules. Let's go to the rescale color map. Look at that interface. Okay, so we have it set to auto scale right now, so it's going to take whatever data it comes in and use that to scale the color map. We could switch it to fixed scale if we wanted to, but that doesn't, we don't need to mess with that right now. But what it does tell us is that, okay, the lowest color is going to be negative 17, and the highest color is going to be 9.21 whatever. Okay, but that doesn't really tell us what's going on in the middle. So really what we want to do is have some sort of color bar. So let's go ahead and go grab a new module. It's called Show Color Map. Okay, and just like a show field, it takes in the thing it's supposed to show and sends it to the view scene. So the thing this is supposed to show is a color map. So yeah, take that output of rescale color map and send it in. And then send it over to the view scene. Oh man, the Windows interface really is a pain in the butt, isn't it?
Whoever colored the inputs and outputs like they did, that was a great decision.
I think it's because you're grabbing the wrong port. You should switch to the Manhattan style ones. It makes it a little bit easier.
Okay, and how?
So go up to window settings. Or preferences.
Preferences, okay.
And then network editor. And then Manhattan. There you go. You can also zoom in. You're pretty far zoomed out. So the zoom in is shift and then scroll wheel. If you don't have a scroll wheel, I can't help you.
I think my scroll wheel's broken. So, yeah. Oh, perfect. We'll stay zoomed out for now.
All right, cool. Now hit run.
There's the plus and minus up at the top. Magnifying glasses.
You're right. There is. There you go. That should help you click the modules a little bit better. All right, cool. We have a color map. All right, but I gave you a third piece of data. So let's go ahead and read that in. I'm going to tell you now it's a field. So we're going to need another read field.
All right. Okay. Where I'm going.
You're going to open it up.
And it's the heart one, right?
Yep. So you're in the right folder. You just need to change the file type.
Oh, yeah. Okay, and it's loading in heart.
Yep.
Okay.
All right. And then what do we need to do to be able to actually see it?
Show field.
Yep. So we're going to drop in a show field module.
Can I copy the show field module?
Oh, do not use the copy paste function. It will cause your computer to freeze up real good.
Great. I'm glad I asked before I did it.
It does work, and so does the undo button also works. They're just not very fast.
Oh, the undo is perilous. I've done control copy and paste, and it's painful. Control Z is bad.
It has to reverse engineer the Python commands that it needs to remove them. It's a whole thing.
So don't do it.
Okay, and then you need to drag that into the view scene. All right, now hit play.
But it doesn't have a color scale.
Isn't that nice and ugly?
Yeah, it is.
So the problem that we're having here is that we're wanting to look at our heart geometry, but also our data at the same time, right? But it's kind of hard to see because the heart geometry and the data geometry overlap each other. There's a number of solutions we could do. We could try making the heart geometry transparent, right? So if we go into show field, we can select transparency, enable transparency on the faces, and then go ahead and go over to the edges and disable them. So hit the tab that says edges.
Oh, edges, okay.
And then unclick show edges. Okay, that's a little better, right? But it still looks weird. So what we might actually want to do is map that data onto our heart mesh, right? Map the data from the sock to the heart. In order to do so, there are a number of various different ways, and I'm just going to show you a very simple one, which is linear interpolation. Okay, so go ahead and grab a module called Map Field Data from Source to Destination. Nice and long descriptive name. All right, so it should be the third one down, map field data from source to destination. Go ahead and drag that in. Okay, and so this is going to be kind of hard to see if you're not zoomed out. So go ahead, or if you're so zoomed out. So go ahead and close your view scene window and zoom in.
Oh, this again. There we go.
Do like one or two more. Actually, this is probably good. This is probably good. So go ahead and grab the output from your heart mesh read field.
Output. Wait, so I'm grabbing it straight from the read field.
Yep, straight from there. And just drag and hold it. All right, so see how it highlights source and destination? Okay, is the heart mesh the source or the destination?
It's the destination, right? The data would be the source, right?
All right, so drag it into the destination port. Okay, and then now we need to drag the geometry that has the data on it into the source. Okay, so where is that in our network?
It comes from the read matrix and the matrix slice. However, that's not the right color. So I would assume it comes from our set field data, the output of our set field data.
Yep, that's right. And if you ever get confused about any of this, about like what module is doing what, first off, you can organize them, right? You can move them around to wherever you want them to be. But secondly, you can create notes on each individual module. So if you hit the little settings button next on a module, like the little, you know, settings gear, there's an option that's called Edit Notes. And then if you click that, you can enter in a note, say this maps the data or something like that. Right? And you can see that that note shows up next to the module inside the editor. So you hit, yeah, okay, or close or whatever. Okay, and then that can help you to understand what's going on more. All right, so now we have a field where we've mapped data from source to destination, but this module has a bunch of options. So let's go see what options we're using. All right, so interpolation basis is linear. That's probably a good one to use. It's also setting no maximum distance. So if we leave that as it is, then it's gonna linearly interpolate across the entire surface. If we wanted to change that and unclick no maximum, then we could set what the maximum distance is, and then we also set what the default value is outside of there. So it says, I'm gonna linearly interpolate up to a certain distance, and then beyond that distance, I'm gonna set it to some default value. Let's just leave it all as it is right now and close it up. And then let's go ahead and visualize the output of this. So in order to do so, we need a show field. And a view, and then we're going to pipe in the data that we want to show, or the field that we want to show.
So I'm connecting this to the map.
Yep.
Field data. All right.
And then we also need a color map on it, right? Because it's got data on it and we want to see the color. But let's just use the color map that we've already created. So grab the output of rescale color map and drag it on over.
Oh, geez. I'm just going to hope that this.
Yep, that looks right.
Because my zoom, like the little box is blocking it.
Oh, nice. And then drag the show field into the view scene.
Drag, the show field into the view scene.
Yep. There you go. All right, now hit play. Let's see what we got. All right, so there's too much going on here. We need to turn off some of the things in order to actually see what's going on. So go up to the settings, the little wrench and screwdriver.
I'm sorry, I'm missing half of it.
All right, let's go ahead and switch over to Nate real quick so we can fix what he's got going on. And also, so if you go up to the settings window, on the view scene, the little wrench and screwdriver. You got them all there.
Didn't look like his did because his was colored in up here as well.
Didn't look like he probably needs to turn on color map lookup.
Yeah, go to show field.
This one?
Yep. Go to its options. Okay, it's on color map lookup. Go ahead and up to the field name. Name it something descriptive. Call it heart with data or something like that. Or descriptive, that works too. All right, now rerun the whole network. This is just a sanity check to make sure. So now if you go into the settings window, right, heart with data. Okay, so uncheck everyone else. And then you can just drag that out of the way or leave it. Interesting. Interesting. How did you accomplish that? So the input to your map from source to destination, right? What's the source?
So the source is this file, the SOC MATLAB. No, that's the destination. And so the source.
So the source should be the sock with data on it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And the destination should be the heart. It looks like your destination is the sock.
Oh, well, that would do it. Okay.
Okay, now try running it. There you go.
There we go. Okay.
And you guys see that weird artifact there on the cap that just looks completely weird?
Mm-hmm.
Why do you think that's happening?
Because of the linear interpolation, it's all meeting up at these points and it's creating discontinuities.
So the main reason is that we only have data here, quit spinning it. We only have data up to this point right here. Wow, you picked it. Difficult color map to draw on.
Oh, yeah.
No, you're good. You're good. So we only have data up to that point right there, right? And because it's linear, right, it's going to go ahead and say, okay, for all of these points right here, the nearest point to them is this, and the best way to linear interpolate out from there is that, like, there's nothing to interpolate between. So it just essentially just grabs the nearest one, right? It goes through the whole effort of linearly interpolating it, but the functional consequence when there's nothing, like when there's no data in different locations, it ends up just extending it past there. So we might want to go into our map from source to destination. And we might want to give it a maximum distance, right? And so these units are in whatever units the native mesh is in, which I believe this one is in centimeters or millimeters. So let's go ahead and just try one and see how that looks, right? And it's going to assign zero outside of that, and that looks fine, right? The thing you don't want to see is you don't want to see holes of poor interpolation on the... Does that look right? Right, let's toggle back and forth between that and the measured data. So go ahead and drag this window off to the side so we can toggle them. Okay, so there's the heart with the data mapped on. There's the color bar. There's the sock. Yeah, it looks more or less right. Okay, granted that linear interpolation is very simplistic. Okay, so through this, you all should have the ability now to read in a geometry, read in some data that corresponds to that geometry, and visualize it. And then this is one example of mapping some data from one source to another. This is a very simple method for doing so, but in certain cases, it's all you need. Does anybody have any questions?
So I had a question about the different colors that the pipes are. Mm-hmm. What is there like a legend for like what those are supposed to mean, or are they just there so you can tell what's what?
I mean, so there, I don't know if there's any official legend on what they mean, but they do, like, so fields are yellow.
Okay.
View scenes are purple, matrices are blue, or view scenes are pink. Color maps are purple. There's also a couple other data types that have their own unique colors. So yeah, it's mostly meant as a guide to show you where different data can and cannot go.
Oh,
and okay. what certain, so if you drag in a new module and it has all these different colored input ports, that kind of gives you a sense of what kinds of input that module can take.
Okay, that makes sense, yeah.
Or requires.
Okay, cool.
So we've just barely scratched the surface with this tutorial, but we also came in just about at the right time. I also created another network that we would have had no hope of getting through, according to Lindsay, which is true based on how long everything takes. And this is it, right? And what I wanted to show you guys with this network, I'll send it out for you to play with if you want, is that this is another example of how you can use SCIRun. And then in this case, it is doing a simple simulation where you can move electrodes around and it'll calculate an electric field between them and visualize it using isosurfaces. Right, so I can move around the blue being the negative pole and the red being the positive pole, and then all of those little surfaces are iso voltage surfaces. Kind of the cool thing about SCIRun is if you can think of a problem that you're having or a thing you want to, a way you want to manipulate data, there's probably a way to do it in SCIRun.